everything else we've learned so far this week continues to grow in impact. The process of holding Meadows in contempt of Congress, it revealed a lot, including the remarkable fact that Congressman Jim Jordan, the man who's next in line to chair the Judiciary Committee if Republicans take the House, was himself pushing a plan to overturn the election. Now, just to remind you, here's the relevant portion of the text he forwarded to Mark Meadows.
I want to display just a few of the message he received from people in Congress. The committee is not naming these lawmakers at this time, as our investigation is ongoing. If we could cue the first graphic. This one reads, on January 6, 2021, Vice President Mike Pence, as President of the Senate, should call out all electoral votes that he believes are unconstitutional as no electoral votes at all. You can see why this is so critical to ask Mr. Meadows about.
Now, yesterday, Congressman Jordan revealed that he was the one who sent that to Meadows. So the guy touting the very same playbook the former president was pushing Mike Pence to spearhead, the ranking member of the House Judiciary Committee, fronting for a legal fig leaf to cover an attempted coup. The same Jim Jordan, who's rarely at a loss for words unless the question concerns his conversations with the former president that day, something you would think he might remember.
On January 6th, did you speak with him before, during, or after the Capitol was attacked?
I'd have to go. I spoke with him that day after, I think after. I don't know if I spoke with him in the morning or not. I just don't know. I'd have to go back and I don't know when those conversations happened, but what I know is I spoke with him all the time.
Well, you take that, his continued embrace of the election lie, and yesterday's revelation about him pushing that justification for overthrowing a free and fair election, and you've got all the makings of a potential witness for the Select Committee. Amazingly, however, he wanted to be on the committee. House Speaker Pelosi said no, and ever since, including in this week's contempt vote against Mark Meadows, House Republicans have been crying foul.
I understand Pelosi didn't want Jim Jordan, for example, on the committee, but I can assure you, Republicans didn't want Adam Schiff or Jamie Raskins on the committee.
We have a January 6th committee that Nancy Pelosi is leading that is nothing but a political witch hunt on Republicans and Trump supporters.
Did she set the committee itself to be one-sided? Yes. More so than any select committee before? Yes, she did.
The vote would have possibly been different if it had been more legitimate of a committee.
We warned you from that moment in time she was playing politics.
As they've proven yet again today, over and over again, they only care about attacking their political enemies.
That it really has turned out to be nothing more than a partisan committee just to investigate the former president.
I think it's very clear to the American public, this is a sham.
Well, keep it honest, it's not. But it might have been. So far from what we know of the committee, it's been diligent, focused on facts, and not tangents, and seems to have bent over backwards to accommodate witnesses, even when they're trying to obstruct or delay the committee's work, like Mark Meadows. The two Republicans who do serve on the committee have distinguished themselves across party lines. Joining us now is Washington Post opinion columnist Dana Milbank. His latest piece is titled, Meadows' Texts Show Trump Did What GOP Falsely Claimed Clinton Did in Benghazi. In it, he writes this about Jim Jordan. Quote, Jordan, in his addendum to the Benghazi report, wrote that the Obama administration, quote, so blinded by politics and its desire to win an election, disregarded a basic duty of government, tell the people the truth. He continues, 5 years later, with democracy itself on the line, Jordan and his colleagues are fighting the truth as if their very survival depends on it. Dana, thanks for joining us. When you see Jim Jordan now, compared to the Jim Jordan of the Benghazi investigation, I mean, how do you explain the difference?
Well, you can't explain it. I mean, look, your viewers are not going to be shocked to know that there's hypocrisy in politics. And there's always been some element of, you know, where you stand depends on where you sit, on which side of the aisle. But there's something more going on here. And I think this really reveals the sickness, because not only have people like Jordan sort of forsaken their professed principles to the truth and to the importance of the executive and cooperating with legitimate committees of Congress, but he's doing so in order to sabotage democracy itself. look, it is absolutely essential to get to the bottom of what happened on January 6th so that we don't have another coup attempt, because you can be sure the people who attempted it the first time are trying to learn so they can get it right the next time. So you have Jim Jordan and the others who are basically using a campaign of lies to destroy the investigation into January 6th, of course, in service of the big lie of the election itself. So I think we need to call this sort of thing out. We have democracy is basically on a knife's edge right now. It really could go either way. And this just can't be allowed to stand.
I want to read something else you wrote. You said the differing responses to the two tragedies show the rank hypocrisy in the Republican Party and the sickness that has taken hold of it. I mean, essentially, you're saying that what they were arguing, what the Republicans were arguing or trying to say happened in Benghazi is what actually happened, is what the President Trump actually did during the insurrection. Can you just explain that?
Well, sure. I mean, there were years. It was all we heard about was Benghazi, 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 at least until we found out about Hillary's emails. But the whole idea was, you'll recall, there was supposedly this stand down order. The Republicans alleged that the military could have come to the rescue of the Americans at the consulate in Benghazi, but somebody gave a stand-down order, and that wasn't allowed to happen. In fact, that was not the case. There was no stand-down order, and certainly Hillary Clinton had nothing to do with assigning the military to do anything. So, but here you have a case where even more people died, and it wasn't just a diplomatic outpost. It was the capital of the United States being attacked. We know that the president was being called upon to do something to stop the attack by his own supporters. And talk about a stand-down order. He waited 3 hours something before even saying they should go home. And we know the Pentagon was slow-walking these desperate pleas to have the National Guard come out there. So basically what was falsely alleged to have happened in Benghazi is exactly what happened on January 6th. So where is the outrage?
What would have happened if Jim Jordan was on the January 6th Select Committee? I mean, obviously, you know, he's big on trying to grab attention, derail things. What do you think would have happened?
Well, look, as you illustrated there, he was very clearly all about sabotaging the committee, as was Jim Banks, the other member that Nancy Pelosi objected to. Look, Jim Jordan participated in a Stop the Steal rally. How can you have somebody like that investigating January 6th? I think it was a tactical mistake of Kevin McCarthy to boycott the committee entirely, because now you have legitimate, serious people like Cheney and Kinzinger joining with the Democrats to actually get to the bottom of it. And even though we're seeing a whole lot of stonewalling in terms of the testimony, they are getting a hold of the documents, as we see from these the Meadows text messages. So it appears they will be able to put together the story, and this needs to be told in full accuracy.
Yeah. Dana Milbank, I appreciate it. Thank you. Really fascinating.
Thanks, Anderson.